Faith-Lilac Ways and Light Worship. My name is Pastor Pam Stahlheim Lane, and I'm glad that you have joined me and our worship team for our Epiphany worship today. We also offer in-person sanctuary and radio worship in our parking lot at 9:30 on Sunday mornings, and education classes on Sunday morning as well. For those of you who are Faith Lilac Way members, our annual meeting will be Sunday, February 6th. Please save the date. More information will be coming. Let us begin with our gathering hymn.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us and lead us, that we may bathe in the glory of your Son, born among us, and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as free and forgiven children of God. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you.
reading from Isaiah, the 62nd chapter. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest, until her vindication shines out like the dawn, and her salvation like a burning torch. The nation shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be turned forsaken, and your land shall no more be turned desolate. But you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. Word of God, word of life.
According to John, the 2nd chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Will we have enough food? It's a common worry at any event in which you're planning for a large number of people. At one funeral that I was at, in which twice as many people came as were expected, I found myself talking with the caterer. "Can you go get more if you run out?" She shook her head, "No." And then she smiled and said, "This is what we have, and I think there will be enough." I promised to pray for plenty, and then went back to my office. Later, someone came to the office door and said, "Pastor, have you eaten? There are so many leftovers. Come and eat. And when I went downstairs, the caterer looked at me rather slyly and said, "Don't you have a Bible story about this?" I assumed she was referring to the story of Jesus on a remote hillside feeding 5,000 people from 2 loaves and 5 fish. But today's gospel story is about another anticipated shortfall, this time at a wedding. Jesus' mother puts it bluntly, they have run out of wine. Running out of wine would have been a disgrace, a crisis of honor for the family of this newly married couple. But it wasn't a crisis for the whole world, and Jesus even asks his mother, well, what does it have to do with us? And yet Mary knew, somehow, that it was important for this family. It was important for these people, and she knew that Jesus could help. And so she doesn't argue. She simply tells the servants, do what he says. She knows that he has the power to change the situation from being disgraceful to being full of grace. And he does. The wine steward doesn't know where this wine came from, and so he was amazed and puzzled. But the servants knew, and so did the disciples. And they had a different response. They believed. They believed in Jesus. Perhaps that is why John doesn't call this a miracle. He calls it a sign. As wonderful as the wine must have tasted, it's a sign. It's simply a sign that points. It points to Jesus and reveals something of who Jesus is. This story reveals Jesus as one who not only listened to his mother, but also as one who, by using ordinary water, creates an abundance of the finest wine, a symbol of joy and delight in the midst of perceived scarcity and shame. And he engages ordinary people to make this happen. Jesus did this quite openly, but only the disciples, those who were paying attention, were able to see the sign. They saw God. The other guests, they simply enjoyed the wine. Where do you see God? What signs point to Jesus in our community? This is a question we always ask our youth when we go on mission trips. But it is a question that should not be reserved for the times in which we are away doing God's work. This is a question for us, for all of us, every day. Because God is at work in our world every day, right where we are. But do not despair if you find sometimes that it's difficult to see God. Because it's easy to get distracted by the to-do lists, the schedules, and routines of your daily life. Or maybe you get sucked in by social media or trying to figure out how to keep yourself and your family safe in this crazy pandemic and politically divisive world. Or for those of you with kids, how to navigate school online, especially when the rules keep changing. Or maybe it's hard to see God if you're full of grief, loneliness, or despair. And, or you may just be weary. And yet, it is at times like these, times in which it feels like there is a crisis of scarcity, a crisis of faith, a crisis of lack of hope, it is at these times that God invites you to simply stop just for a moment and pay attention. Because God is still at work in our world. And sometimes in those crisis times, those are the times we can best pay attention. One of the places that you can see God is in nature. In fact, everywhere you look in nature, you can see God's fingerprints. I have found that on those days that I pay attention, I see the God who created heaven and earth revealed in the beauty of two spectacular light shows, one at sunrise and the other at sunset. They happen every day, even when I'm not paying attention. And so many other times as well. But God is also at work, in addition to nature, God is at work in the people, however God finds us. For when we do pay attention, we can see that God delights in taking those things in us, those things that are empty, and filling them to the brim. This is true for empty jars in Cana, which suddenly holds the finest wine, ready to gladden the hearts of those who are celebrating the joining of two people in marriage. And this is true for empty, broken hearts and lives that are mourning the loss of loved ones, the loss of hopes, the loss of dreams. All these Jesus wants to fill to the brim with love, new hopes, new dreams. There are signs all around us, in nature, in people, and in the world around us. And it is our call to pay attention so that we can see and share and we can taste and live into the grace of God. This weekend, we celebrate Martin Luther King Jr. Day. He was a person who was very much paying attention to the world around him and paying attention to what God was up to. And so I would like, in closing, I'd like to read a passage from one of his sermons. It's called The Death of Evil on the Seashore. King speaks about the power of God who is at work in the universe, and he pays attention. He writes, "A God who is not outside the world, looking on with a sort of cool indifference. Here on all of the roads of life, God is striving in our striving. As we struggle to defeat the forces of evil, the God of the universe struggles with us. Evil dies on the seashore, not merely because of man's endless struggle against it, but because of God's power to defeat it. When our days become dreary with low hovering clouds, and our nights become darker than a thousand midnights, let us remember that there is a great benign power in the universe whose name is God, and he is able to make a way out of no way and transform dark yesterdays into bright tomorrows. Thanks be to God who makes it so. Let us pay attention so that we can see it, feel it, taste it, and live it. In Jesus' name, amen."
Thank you.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Jesus, give us eyes to see and lips to taste the goodness of work in our world as you fill to the brim all that was empty, and give us hope for bright tomorrows. God of grace, by your Spirit, grant wisdom, knowledge, and discernment to those who hold leadership positions at any level. Direct policymakers toward decisions that build up safe and just communities. Lead all authorities in seeking and serving the common good. God of grace, we give thanks for the life of Martin Luther King Jr. and all who have modeled the way of courageous faith. God of grace, as Jesus provided generously in a moment of need, provide abundantly for all who are hungry or thirsty, all seeking shelter, and all who seek peace. God of grace, you bless us with healing. Bring relief to those in need, especially Lois Anderson, Donna Benson, Carol Brown, Jacqueline Bukowski, Larry Gere, Carolyn Loggison, Joyce Merkel, Margaret Penzimas, Herb Schelk, Lucas Wisty, and Vic Woolgar, and all those who we name with our lips or in our hearts. God of grace, in thanksgiving, we lift before you the saints for whom the promise of salvation has now been fulfilled, especially Lori Schumacher. Tend to those who mourn, especially Dan Schumacher and his family. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. God of grace, since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Amen.
Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
righteousness, who rejoices over you and calls you by name. Bless your going out and your coming in, today and forever. Amen.
Go in grace, grow in faith, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.